The earnings that we saw reflective of what happened already doesn't necessarily obviously reflect of what's going to happen in the future. And people like to look just at supply chain, but all of these stores also sell food and products that people need. And those costs just continue to rise. So you've got the supply chain. Obviously, you've got the labor issues. You've got the issues with once it gets off the ships, if it can get off the ships, how it's going to get delivered. But there's something else that's so insidious that keeps rocking. And I don't hear enough people talking about it other than complaining about when they go to the grocery store. And that is these rising food prices, which you can't just magically make disappear because it's Mother Nature, and we're not at the point yet where technology can supplant raw material, and particularly as we're looking at food. So when you're looking at like something like Walmart and Target in particular, that would be part of it. That along with the fact that people are nervous. They're shopping early, and that's what we saw with the retail sales that came out yesterday, positive. But I think going forward, if we cannot resolve what's happening here with these rising food prices and they go parabolic, then I think that all of the retail chains will start to really feel the pinch.
Michelle, do you think that that's the biggest threat to the stock market rally is higher prices and consumers not being able to absorb them the way they have been thus far?
Absolutely. I mean, there's a thing called pricing power. So that's really what this is all about. Because essentially, if companies have to continue to pass those higher costs on to consumers, and consumers continue to feel pinched, then in spite of all the corporate buybacks, that will be an issue, especially with corporate buybacks, which have been incredibly high. If the market starts to melt down for any reason, if fear starts to come in, which we're starting to see a little bit today after all of this greed, then who are these corporations going to sell to? And that's really, I think, my biggest fear is that we go more into a stagflation environment as we head into 2022.
But there are areas that you like, and EV is one of them. And I wonder how much of the interest that we're seeing in some of these stocks, Rivian, Lucid, Tesla, has to do with this infrastructure massive bill that just passed.
Well, they're getting some tax credits, as we know, and charging stations are part of it. And of course, the administration and on also the heels of the whole global situation are very much in favor of alt energy. And I heard the comment in the beginning of the show about oil in and of itself and with the Biden administration opened the spigot. I don't think so. I think that the reason why he's investigating the FTC is because he doesn't want to do that. He's committed to clean energy. So, yeah, I think that could shine in 2022 with the caveat that if the whole market crashes, there's a liquidity crisis that can happen. Everything will go down. But when the dust settles, that would be one of the first places I'd look. And if we don't wind up in that scenario, because the Fed obviously is not going to do anything much to upset this apple cart, then I would still look there as opportunities. Companies like Blink and Plug, we also just like Tan and PBW. Those are the areas that I think we'd like to put our money most in terms of what has growth opportunity in 2022.
I know, Michelle, that you are bullish on metals, you're bullish on crypto heading into 2022, but a moment ago you mentioned stagflation. Are those good plays in that environment, and how are you setting up the portfolio to be defensive if you have to be?
Well, I do think that they're very good plays in both scenarios. I mean, we've seen that cryptocurrency and the relationship to what's happening in the economy right now is more speculative. We can't say hard and fast like we could say back 1979, gold and silver, when we were in sort of coming at the end of a stagflation environment. But what we can say right now is if we talk about silver and gold, we know they're very undervalued. They're really basing out here, even on a day where the market is starting to come off. Silver and gold are still up on the day. And I think that could be signs of a place of some type of safety play if things get out of control, particularly as we just talked about with food prices. So, yeah, I would definitely say that if you didn't get yourself into silver and gold, one thing you could watch is that ratio between silver and gold, because when silver outperforms, generally that means we're heading into an inflationary cycle. And the stagflation part will come from the fact that we've already seen a lack of growth. And if that lack of growth continues, we could still see those precious metals outperform.
Michelle, this year was all about taking risks, right? But how risk on are you looking forward out into the second half of next year, let's say?
Well, I like to look at the relationships in terms of risk on. So there are really three key relationships to keep your eye on, which have been sort of switching between risk on, risk off in the last couple of days. One is how the long bonds perform against the S&P 500. The bonds, people are saying that bonds are not going to be a safety play, and nor is obviously equities for 2022 if things get worse. But nonetheless, that doesn't matter. To me, what matters is if the long bonds actually outperform the S&P 500, that's risk off. Right now, the S&P is still outperforming. You want to look at high yield junk bonds, because if they are doing well versus the long bonds, again, risk on. If they start to turn down, risk off. And then finally, since infrastructure is so key to our growth for 2022, look at the transportation sector and how that's performing against the SPY. That was outperforming until, guess what, today. So that now tells me that unless that flips back, I would definitely be more careful in terms of accumulating equities, especially those that have had very lofty prices and have a lot of risk if things go down.
Okay, a great conversation there. Michelle Schneider, MarketGage.com partner and director of trading research and education. Thank you so much for your insight and perspective.